Hey, Ant here. So I've got the DJI Mavic Air 2 on pre-order, and I've been flying around for about a month now. I think it's pretty sick. Hear my thoughts. So up front, DJI Mavic Air 2 is pretty, well, I think it's pretty spec heavy. They packed a lot of features into it. So I'm just gonna rattle through a few of them now quickly. So it shoots up to 4K 60 frames per second, 1080p 240 frames per second. It shoots 120 megabytes per second, 8-bit 48 megapixel raw photos, 8K hyperlapse, HDR video, 34 minute flight time. It has a 24 millimeter f2.8 lens. It has a D-Cine-like color profile. It weighs 570 grams, has a 1/2-inch CMOS sensor. It has OcuSync 2.0, and it also has internal 8 GB storage. Handy. I seriously doubt this is the first DJI Mavic Air video you've seen, but hopefully I might cover something someone else has missed. So I got the Fly More combo. So it came with this really nice, like, weather sealed bag. You have a pouch in the front here, which has just some spare props and cords and stuff. And then into the main pouch, we have all the action. So as you can see, there's like a little slot up here. It came with this little adapter dongle thing. You use it to plug into your batteries, and you can actually use your drone batteries as a portable charger then for your other devices. Just has two USB ports there and plugs in there to your drone battery. So it also has this really nice little ND filter kit. It comes with a 16, 64 and 256. So the Fly More combo also came with three of these guys and a multi-charger, which is like super handy. Although the one thing I have noticed is it seems to charge them one at a time. So it still takes the same time to charge three batteries. And then we got the remote, and then the star of the show, we have the drone. Searching for the focus peaking. This is the spot. Yeah, there we go. Boom. So the arms, you know the deal, they just fold out. Exactly the same as the Pros and the other Air and whatnot. It comes with a gimbal mount as well, but I lost it already. In terms of sensors, the drone has two on the front, two on the back, two underneath as well. It also has an LED down here, which is you're supposed to use for, you know, landing in the dark on like unknown terrain, that sort of thing. But for me, that is probably like the last thing I'm gonna use it for. I think there could be some really cool applications for the LED under the drone, like maybe painting in some landscapes for some long exposure or something like that. You know, I think it could be really fun to experiment and see what everyone is doing with that. So in terms of the ND filters, you just hold the gimbal and twist and they pop on and off just like that. Which is, you know, it's a super smart, super simple way of doing it. Although my one complaint is it's a bit fidgety, and I've actually dropped the filters on dirt a couple times, which isn't great, especially if it gets some scratches on it. But hey, what are you gonna do? So the drone comes with a 24mm f2.8, which is a nice wide field of view, because it means you don't need to fly as far out to get those nice wides, which actually also saves you a bit of battery as well. So in terms of the remote, this chunky guy, it's pretty big, which isn't great for travel, but in terms of actual use, it feels really ergonomic, like all the buttons are right where you want them to be, and just feels really good in the hand. So the antenna are built into the phone holder, which is just makes so much sense. And also the phone holder is now on top of the remote, which again is great. I mean, it was just awkward looking down at the bottom of your remote. New app is just called DJI Fly, and it's basically just a slightly less pro version of the DJI Pro app. That's, you know, it's not necessarily a bad thing because it just makes it super simple and easy to use. So once you're in video mode, you get to choose between normal, HDR, and slow-mo. All you do is you change your resolution and frames per second and you're away. Once you've got your basic information selected, you can dial in your manual options in the bottom right hand corner. You can change the ISO and the shutter speed. So in photo mode, it defaults to single, which is just a 12 megapixel photo, but you've also got the options to change it to 48 megapixel photo, smart, which just evaluates the scene and does its own thing, and then exposure bracketing, which is AEB mode. So we also have 8K hyperlapses or 1080p. No middle ground, you either get 1080 or 8K. In theory, this is sick, it's amazing. Like 8K hyperlapses, you can get so creative with that. In practice though, I haven't seen any good applications of this yet. I think maybe if you're like a couple hundred meters away from like anything, then it's gonna work. But to be honest, it just gets blown around in the wind way too much. Even if you're just doing a simple, just small track in towards something, you can tell the drone's just going all over the place. Yeah, hopefully they'll do some software wizardry to kind of make it a bit better. But I'd say, yeah, this is only really usable if you're doing like massive big landscapes away from like anything. So for those of you that don't know, 48 megapixels is pretty big, and you know, having detail in your photos is great if you want to like, you know, crop into your images to like isolate certain elements, if you're printing your images large scale, or if you just want some super crispy shots for your gram, even though that probably doesn't matter as much. So beyond the standard photo and video modes, the drone includes some really cool modes for you to kind of play with. And these modes generally are just pretty sick, just for like sending stuff to your phone, just for like some social content or whatever. So the first of these modes is quick shot. These are limited to 1080p, hence why they're good for, you know, just social content for you to send to your phone. Really handy if you just want to get like a really cool shot of yourself without like actually having to hold the remote. So you kind of just select you on the screen and then press start, and then you can kind of just dash the remote and then do your thing, and it will track you while doing the movement. So it means, I guess you can just look a little bit more authentic. So the first on the list of quick shots is the droney. This is just the classic, you know, pull back and up and feel your scene kind of thing. You've seen it before. It's a classic. The next is rocket. And you guess it just goes straight up, gives you a bird's eye view of wherever you are. You know, probably pretty cool for some like poolside shots or something like that. Next on the quick shots list is circle. And you guess it, does a circle around you. The next one is helix. This one is the same circle, just circles around you, but at the same time it pulls away from you. So it kind of creates a circle whilst getting further and further away. This is cool, but drone doesn't have any side sensors. So while the drone is going sideways in a circle and further away, you better make sure there are no trees around. I tried this out and I literally had to dash for the remote and press stop because it was, I don't know, a meter away from hitting a tree. So the next one is boomerang. Pretty similar to the previous two quick shots, except supposedly it does the shape of a boomerang, like kind of a bit more oblong. So the last on the quick shot list is asteroid, and this is by far my favorite mode. It's like so much fun. Essentially it mixes a droney and a 360 video together. So it pulls out from wherever you are and then stops, takes a 360 video and blends them together, and then creates the shot for you. So literally you can just send it to your phone and upload it. It's pretty sick. So the next mode is panoramas. They're pretty fun to play with as well. Essentially, what it can do is it can stitch together a bunch of different photos. It does it pretty well, pretty seamlessly, and just creates like, there's a whole host of them. Like, you can get vertical ones, you can get, you know, the wide panoramas, you can just get a wide shot, which stitches like 9 photos together. So DJI updated the tracking in this drone, and it is a world better than my last drone, which was the original Mavic Pro. It's a lot more reliable. It just sticks to the subject a lot better, and also is apparently much better at finding the subjects once they're lost as well. So all you need to do is draw a little box around whoever you want to track, and then you're presented with a couple options. So the first of the tracking modes is trace. This essentially just does the basic job of tracing and keeping the subject roughly in the middle of the image. It's really good if you want to add your own camera movements. It will kind of automatically keep the subject in frame. The next is parallel. Essentially, this keeps the drone parallel to the direction that the subject is going. Works pretty well. What I have noticed is that it kind of lags a little bit behind the subject. This is my favorite application of active track on the drone. Essentially, you can set the drone on the subject and then set it to revolve around the subject in whichever direction you want and whatever speed you want. I've just got some really cool shots like this. I think it's, the shots look really dynamic and really cool. And at the same time, you can also use the controller to send the drone higher or lower or further closer or further away while it's doing the circular motion as well. So what do I think of the drone? I think for 800 odd pounds, it's a ridiculous steal. I mean, you're not going to find anything else on the market for that money, which is that like feature packed. It kind of just feels like DJI has put all of their knowledge over the last however many years of making drones into making this one just super refined and just well made, and like the software's super clean, works really well. It's just a great drone. There's no anxiety once it's in the air. It doesn't feel like it's gonna crash or suddenly drop out of the sky or the wind's gonna take it off or anything like that. It just feels really solid, especially for the size. So in terms of just the footage, I think it's pretty good. I'm more than happy to use the footage in any of my films, to be honest. Even client stuff, I think it's definitely up to par. Obviously, it's not quite as good as, say, the DJI Mavic Pro 2 with its inch sensor and Hasselblad lens. Yeah, and also it's 10-bit as opposed to the drone's 8-bit. So it's always going to look better. It's always going to have more, you know, great ability. But it's, you know, a few hundred quid more. You know, if you're doing more like drone focus work, then I think maybe that might be a wiser choice. But for me, I travel a lot, so I really appreciate the small size of this one. And I don't really do like super drone heavy films. For me, like, drones are really good for like establishing a scene or an area, or it's just like added value, you know? But it's not the meat of my films. I've actually never really enjoyed flying drones that much. For me, it's always been about getting the shots. But this drone's actually a lot of fun just to throw in the air and fly. Like, you sling it in sports mode and this thing shifts. It goes so fast. Well, it feels like it goes so fast anyways. Hope you enjoyed my review on the Mavic Air 2. Hopefully you learned something which you might not have known, or it helps you come closer to making a decision. Either way, if you enjoyed, like, comment, sub, or don't. Either way, have an awesome day. Cheers.